Yesterday you have seen a beautiful talk by Michele, and it was showing, no, the day before maybe, it was showing many very cool applications of this method of metadynamics, so you already should have an idea of what it is. And in this hour, I will try to like start from scratch and explain like the very basic ideas behind metadynamics, and I will try to also follow to give you some sort of formal proof why it works, how it works exactly. So I think you should be able to. So this actually is quite complementary to what Michele was showing, and maybe it would have been even better to see first this one. But you can always say that in this way now you already know that metadynamics is very useful, and so you are more motivated in learning how it works. Okay, so we know already this thing. So we know already that we have this problem. We assume that we have a collective variable that describes this transition. We know already that there are good collective variables and bad collective variables. We will learn more about that in the afternoon. In practice, this is very important. But then now let's just assume that this is your problem and you want to accelerate this transition. And you are in the case where the transition is not happening because just in the middle you have something which is some region which is unlikely to be explored. So Max was showing to you that you can build a bias potential on this collective variable which compensates for this like shape here, and if you compensate it, basically you will end up on in a flat free energy surface, total free energy plus bias, and so the system will be able to go back and forth. And this is the idea behind it right now. So the way it's implemented, it's very simple. So what you do is you build some history-dependent potential, which is a sum over the past. History, CT prime, SNT. And then you have to choose some factor here which tells you how big is the Gaussian, and then how Gaussian. And then you have another factor here, this sigma, which tells you how wide is the Gaussian. And what you do is basically you build your biasing potential as a sum of Gaussians, one after the other. Okay? And then if you apply this to the guy in the double well potential, you see that you are sort of accumulating some sort of sand here, and wherever, if you are in a given position, you add sand there, and of course you don't, if there is some sand there, some potential, repulsive potential, the system will try to avoid to go again in that place, right? It's a small penalty, so it goes somewhere else, then come back and add a new Gaussian and so on. And what happens basically is that in this way you are able to build adaptively a biasing potential which tries to become the one that Max was showing to you, the optimal thing that would be something such that this line is perfectly flat, right? Because if this line up is perfectly flat, then no residual barriers, and your system is able to go back and forth. Okay? So this is the aim, to build something such that this upper line is completely flat, even if in practice you cannot know when it's flat or not, because you don't know the underlying free energy, right? So you only know the shape of the yellow thing, but you have a procedure to build it that automatically makes it such that this line tries to become flat. Okay, this is the idea of this method, and these methods of this class are called flat histogram methods. Yes?
So in practice, this would be like taking an image of where atoms used to be and then applying a potential where they used to be so that they don't break the same location.
Exactly, yes. But, okay, it's not like you don't want them to go there anymore. They will go there. This is just a penalty. And then the other point is you don't do this on atoms. It cannot be done on atoms because atoms are too many. They never go back to the same situation. You do this on collective variables. Okay? You have to do this on a low dimensionality space. So you have to first constrain your problem and say, I can only monitor in any different time. You say, okay, atoms are irrelevant. I just care about this dihedral angle. Okay, atoms should be there to have the proper forces, but then I only monitor the dihedral angle and I try to avoid to be again in the same point for that dihedral angle. Okay, this is very crucial.
So Giovanni, as a generalization, the collective variable doesn't really have to be one-dimensional, right? It can
yeah.
be like some
sort of we will see examples of two-dimensional collective variables. Of two collective variables at the same time.
And then you add like Gaussian, which is actually
exactly. multidimensional. Yeah, exactly. Okay, so then you see that you have these parameters, how quickly you add send to your simulation. And we will discuss in detail the effect of this parameter in the next few slides. And then another parameter that you have here is this sigma, which is the width of your hills. Okay, so this is very much the same as saying, so let's say that your system is here or it's here. So is it the same configuration or not? You have to establish a cutoff. Let's say it's like you do binning for an histogram. And the width of the Gaussian tells you when you are going to distinguish and say, okay, this is a new state or this is just a small perturbation of the old state. So this sigma basically tells you the binning that you do, the resolution that you have in collective variable space. And the typical way to choose it is to do a quick equilibrium simulation, let's say in this minimum, and to check which are the collective variable fluctuations, which is the typical length that the collective variable can do by itself, even without the acceleration. Okay? So if the collective variable without any acceleration is already able to fluctuate of, let's say, 0.1 radians, say that this is an angle, then it means that that's the resolution that you need. Okay, you don't need to distinguish between 1 radian and 1.001 radian, because it's the same angle, basically. Is that clear? Okay. And then at the end of this talk, now we will discuss a lot about this parameter here, the height of the hills. We call these Gaussian hills. And later on, I will tell you something also about how to choose sigma in a better way at the end of this talk, something very recent. Okay, we know already what is a collective variable. It's any continuous function of the microscopic coordinates. We need it to be continuous because it doesn't have to just distinguish state, but you have to have the force on that. So when you compute the force on the atom, you have to apply the chain rule. So force on atom is equal to force on the collective variable times derivative of collective variables with respect to atoms. So it has to be a function that you can take the derivative of. And then, the thing that you have to choose is, in Plumet, you have to say, I want to apply it on this collective variable, this other one, and so on. And then you have to choose the protocol for growing this potential. So you have like the height of the Gaussians, the frequency at which you add them. So if you remember, there was a sum over t prime. Let's say you add a new Gaussian every 100 steps or whatever. Typically, you don't do it at every step because it's too expensive. But you can guess that this is just what counts is just the rate at which you are adding sand. It's like you are doing this tau, this frequency at which you are adding the Gaussian. Oh, okay, tau is not the frequency, it's the stride. And it just tells you that you are using, let's say, a long time step to update the bias. Okay? And every time you add the Gaussian with this height, but what really counts is the rate. So W over tau. How many kcal you add per picosecond, whatever.
So you say,
at each time we apply the bias, of course, but then only every tau steps we update it. Okay, it's a multiple time step in a sense, if you know what it is, multiple time step. Do you know what it is? Okay, but this is the time step for updating the bias. Whereas the bias is used, of course, at every step in MB. And this tau is typically like 1,000 steps or 500 steps, typically, let's say. But what really counts, we will see this rate, and typically this tau should be chosen so that W is smaller than KBT. Because otherwise it means that whenever you add a Gaussian, you are doing a big change on the equilibrium distribution, big jump, which is you are decreasing the probability of being at that point by a factor e to the minus 1. Okay? If you have the height equal to KBT. So typically people try to choose tau so that W is smaller than KBT. But what really counts, this is, let's say, a technicality, whereas the really critical quantity is W over tau. Okay. So I didn't tell you, but you know already because Michele told you, that at the end of this simulation, if this line is flat, it means that even if you didn't know the blue part, you can estimate it from the yellow part. Okay, so the yellow part is like it's equal, should you can expect it to be equal or approximately equal to minus the free energy. Okay, so at the end of the simulation, let's say, you can say, I computed the free energy and it's equal to minus the bias. Yes? Exactly. Yeah. We will see that at the end. Yeah, it's possible to do it on the fly. And it's very important, for example, if you have two wells with different width. Okay, you see that at the end of this simulation, this line is not flat. So there is a residual error. If you go on, this residual error will not disappear. This line will just fluctuate like this. So this means that basically the error that you make in your estimate is related to which are the typical fluctuations of this line up here. So you see that F plus V should be flat. It's not exactly flat, and this is the error that you make when you say that you estimate F from minus B. Okay, so of course you would like to know the error a priori before you do the simulation, or this would be the optimal thing, or maybe even a posteriori after a simulation, but you would like to connect the error with the intrinsic parameters of the system to know, okay, in which case do I need, in which case is it reasonable to use metadynamics, for example, or not? So it's possible to show, and this was done at the first time, like empirically, in this paper, and then in this paper we were able to make like sort of formal proof. I will sketch it in the next slide. It's possible to prove that the squared error, which is like the typical fluctuation of this line here, is proportional to the rate, the deposition rate. So the quicker you fill, the biggest will be these fluctuations. Okay, and is inversely proportional to the diffusion coefficient on this space, which means the slowest is your collective variable, the worst will be your result. Okay?
The error in what?
This is the error on your estimate. So at the end of the simulation, you use the yellow thing to estimate the blue thing. And the error means what you assume is that I don't have. Is Sergio here? Oh, Jim? Can we have the... Or the to write on the blackboard? Yeah. Okay, so what you say is F is equal to minus V, but it's not true. You see, it's not true because this line is not flat. Yes? Is it your personal one? Or? Thank you. Let's try. Okay, plus some constant, of course, which is irrelevant because you just need the free energy up to an arbitrary constant. Okay, so this is the way you estimate the free energy, and this is the error that you make. Thanks. Okay, so it's very important. Very nice to be like, to do like empirical observation, but also I think it's very important to see if they have some theoretical foundation. And what we try to do at some point is okay, let's see of the dynamics of S of the collective variable, and let's see if with that reasonable assumption we can prove that that V is going to become very close to minus F, and very close. I mean, if we can like validate this relationship between the error and V and the position rate and so on. And what we have done is we have developed the formulas to do that. It's very elegant. The idea is, so you make an assumption which is very strong, and indeed this is the real limitation of this work, but you make an assumption on the dynamics of S, which is Langevin dynamics, and then you plug this, so, and then you plug this in this your real dynamics with F plus V. Okay, so you have like as a free, instead of the free energy profile, you have like free energy plus the history dependent potential. You don't have to understand things from here, but this is just to give you a motivation if you want to have a look at this paper. And so basically this is the history dependent potential. This G represents a Gaussian. which was accumulated at the center where the system was in t prime at the previous time, and you evaluate it here to make the derivative to compute the force. And then, so the bad thing of this equation is that it's non-Markovian, which means that the dynamics depends on the history. So the first thing that you have to do if you want to study is equilibrium distribution, which are the fluctuations of this error. You have to recast it in a Markovian way. And indeed, it's possible to do it, just realizing that you can obtain the same dynamics from these coupled Markovian equations. So the first one, so you see what I have done here, I said there is another variable. Not just s, but there is another variable. It's not a variable, it's a function. It's a variable in the function in the sense it's like a fixed value of v on each point. And then I update the bias and update the position at the same time. So, indeed, the MD code is updating the position and Plumet is updating the bias. And so what you do is, okay, when you update the position, you take into account f plus v. When you update the bias, you are at every step, let's say, or if you want, if you go to the limit where tau is equal to zero, you just have the rate. And then you update the bias by adding to it a Gaussian, centering in the place where the system is now. Okay, so like two coupled system, one is the system, your molecular dynamics going around, following forces given by the original force field plus the bias, and then the bias is evolving at the same time, growing in the place where the dynamics is at that time. Okay? So you have this coupled equation, these are Markovian. So since they are Markovian, you can easily apply what we learned, so you can it's possible to see that this equation does not satisfy the tail balance in this extended ensemble. It's very simple to see why. So, the tail balance, you need one trajectory and the opposite trajectory to be possible at the same time. In this case, it's not possible. Why? Because you can only increase the bias. So, there is never the opposite trajectory where you, instead of adding sand, you dig. Okay, so it doesn't satisfy the tail balance. But still it satisfies that balance, and you can find the equilibrium distribution, which can tell you which is the equilibrium, the typical shape of f plus v. And not just the shape, but even the probability of obtaining a well-precise shape. So you can like study its fluctuations in space, the shape of these fluctuations. And then, okay, I just give you the result that, okay, it's very important that to derive this, we assume Langevin dynamics on S. And then you can estimate the error on v plus f, which means okay, it's not really around zero, it's around C, around a constant, but this is irrelevant. And so, and you have this very bad expression, but from here you can just look at the scaling with respect to the parameters that you care, which are 8 of Gaussian, deposition stride, so this rate is the deposition rate, and diffusion coefficient. Okay? So just so that you know that there is a theoretical foundation on that relationship. Yes?
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
How would you know if your fundamental assumption is not valid, that the Langevin dynamics do not apply to that?
So from this is very difficult to know it because you are assuming that in this expression. So you cannot know it from this. So you mean in a practical simulation?
Yeah, I'm curious because the proof relies on this assumption.
Yeah.
Is it possible to ever?
So this assumption is the same as saying that your collective variable represents the slow dynamics of the system. So it's very difficult to test it from the error, but what you can do is we will see. You can test when a collective variable is wrong because metadynamics doesn't converge properly. Basically, what you have is that, or because you have d which is very small, or because this assumption doesn't hold, then the consequence of these two problems is that we will have very big fluctuations in this estimate of f, and we will see it like better probably in the practical tutorial. Okay, so in briefly, let me see what time is it. Okay, so okay, basically you update the bias during the simulation, and then you estimate the free energy from minus the bias. Okay, so from a formal point of view, you can think that the bias that you are building is proportional to the histogram of the visited configurations. That this n is the histogram that you have accumulated of the explored trajectory. And this histogram is basically an integral over time, or a sum over time, if you prefer, of some smoothed function which allows you to build a histogram. It's the same when you choose binning. And this smooth function is typically chosen as a Gaussian. But okay, if this Gaussian is small enough, you can say, in some limit, I can assume that this is just a delta function. And this is very practical for formal derivations, to say that you have infinitely narrow Gaussian. And of course, this assumption makes sense if your Gaussian are substantially smaller than the typical wells that you have in your free energy profile, because they give you the resolution at which you are looking at the system. Okay, so you can interpret the in two ways. In one way, you can say that V is proportional to, one is non-Markovian way. So V is proportional to, and the histogram is non-Markovian because it depends on the past history. And the other is V is updated according to the present position. And this is the Markovian interpretation. Okay? And basically, you can say that this, instead of a Gaussian, what I consider here is like a delta function with some factor in front. Okay? And the factor in front can be shown, okay, a Gaussian function in the limit of very small width becomes a delta function with this factor in front. What is very important is, look, okay, you have some normalization, this is the technicality of the Gaussian, but you also have a factor which is the which is, okay, one dimension, if sigma is not a matrix, it's just a number. This is just the width of the Gaussian. Okay? Because if you have a Gaussian for the same height, which is larger, you are adding more sand. If it's narrower, you are adding less sand. So basically, this number is the amount of sand, and is a normalized amount of sand. Let's say the integral of delta is equal to 1. Okay, well, we will go back to this later. I want to be clear from the beginning, because at the end we will use this. We will see what happens when sigma depends on S. Yes? In practice, you take every fifth or 1,000 configuration by specifying the tau parameters, which is the stride at which you accumulate. But this should be, let's say, chosen small enough that its choice is irrelevant. What only counts, it's like when you analyze a trajectory, it's not relevant to take every single step. If you add Gaussians at every step, you have something where adding the Gaussian becomes the bottleneck, which is very stupid. You want to spend the computer cycle in simulating your molecule. But typically, if you use tau equal to 500 or 1,000 steps, this is completely irrelevant, this cost. And this choice typically is not too long, because, I mean, the collective variable doesn't change so much in 1,000 steps. Otherwise, you would not need metadynamics even. Okay. Yes?
Less parameters on
that. Yes?
It's larger.
Yeah.
Maybe if you are just this shape of the Gaussian.
Yeah.
You have better resolution or?
Worse resolution.
Worse.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like this. Oh, yeah.
Okay. On the other hand, if it's smaller,
yeah,
then you take more time to fill. Why? Imagine that you want to paint completely black a piece of paper with a pencil or with the, I don't know the name, something like this. This is much faster, okay?
Yeah.
Because it's wider.
Less.
You have less resolution, exactly. This is exactly the idea. Yes. Yeah, that depends on the error, it's non-trivial, but in the end, yes, it raises the error. Okay. So, you see that, so we will discuss about sigma at the end. Also because that's some very recent work, so I want to just give you an idea of what we have done. But I will first show you something about this deposition rate. So you should already have realized that you would like this deposition rate to be large because you want to quickly fill your wells and quickly arrive at a reasonable result. But you also would like it to be small because you know that the final error will depend on W. Okay, so with a very small W, you can have more accurate estimate. But also, you will take a lot of time to fill your bathing. So you have to make some compromise, and so the very simple idea is, why don't you change it during simulation? At the beginning, you want it to be large, so that you quickly fill, you do a rude estimate, and then you decrease it. But then there are some subtle issues, so in which way you should decrease it. So there are different possible choices. So this is, let's say that you decrease it as a function of time. I'll show just three examples. Let's say that you decrease it like one over time, which means that, let's say that after 1 nanosecond of simulation, you put is of this side. After 2 nanoseconds, you put is of half the side. Or like 1/t². Or 1/ln of t. Just three examples. This is, in this case, you are decreasing slowly the height. Here you are decreasing quickly the height. And this is what happens. So this is a real simulation again. So what happens is that in this case, so if you compute the integral of this function with respect to t, what you obtain is the amount of sand that you have in your bag before you start the simulation. Okay? And this is finite. With respect to t is a finite number. And this means that you have a finite amount of sand. This means that if you have some error in your estimate, and of course you have, because at the beginning your estimate is completely wrong. D is equal to 0. Okay? So it could be that you don't have enough sand for filling everything.
So is the integral for the beginning?
Infinite. Yes. Even if you do an infinitely long simulation, it could be that you don't have enough sand to complete the filling. Okay? So this is bad. On the other hand, in this case, so look, these pictures are adaptive so that you see that the scale of the y-axis is different here from here. So in this case, on the other hand, these steps on V are decreasing very slowly. And what happens, it can be shown that in this case, the fluctuations are never damped. And if you want, the reason is that the square of this function, which is, to compute the error, the final error, you should have something, you have something which is related to the integral of the squared of this function, because the errors are independent from each other, so you are summing the square of them, and this is going to be divergent. So you need to choose a function so that its integral is convergent, is divergent, so that you have an infinite amount of sand, but the integral of the squared of the function is convergent, so that the error is damped out. And this is very much the same conclusion that you can do when you try to optimize a function using a stochastic estimate of the gradient. You have to decrease the step size exactly with this scaling law. Okay, because since you have a stochastic estimate of the gradient, if you continue to go to move like in the direction of the gradient, you will always make jumps and you will not finish and your simulation, your calculation in the minimum. So you have to decrease the step size exactly with this law. So this is very general idea. So the proper way to decrease the hill's height is 1/time. Okay, but then there is a thing that we didn't like of this. So imagine you first fill the first well. You are at the beginning of the simulation, you are using big hills, so you fill it quickly. Then you go to the second well, and you have already used some of your fill, and so you are going to put smaller hills. So the method works in the end, but the bad thing is that if you have two equivalent wells, you will fill quickly the first, and slowly the second. And then we thought, okay, why should we use the time and not the time spent in that place? So I think we should use here to decide the height of the wheel, the hills, we should use the time spent in this basin. Here we should use the time spent in this basin. Okay, and what happens if you do that? So okay, basically, instead of using the time, you use 1/histogram computed at that point. Okay? Which basically counts how much time you spent there. We tried it, and we saw that it doesn't work. So if you look at the line up there, it's not going to become flat. At the beginning, we thought this was a bug, but in the end, we realized that this is a feature. Yeah. And then we started to sell the feature, say, look, we devised this very cool method to do this thing, which at the beginning we thought it's not working. Okay, and why is not working? The reason is that basically, if you have like a deeper hole, then at the regime you will are going to, when you put this there, it will be smaller. Okay, and so the system will stay more time there before going back. So when you are here, you put small hills, the system stays here for a lot of time, then goes back, and then you put again high hills, and so it goes back quickly. So you are not going to reach an equilibrium, a flat histogram, steady state at the end. The system will not stay the same time, amount of time in all the positions. Okay, so learning from this error, let's say we gave the right formulation behind it, which is exactly the same algorithm, but stated in such a way that we take advantage of this bug, in a sense. In the end, I think it's the best feature of this method is exactly this that at the beginning we thought is a bug. So let's start from scratch. Instead of building the bias as proportional to the histogram, we build it proportional to the logarithm of the histogram. Why proportional to the logarithm of the histogram? Because then you say, at which rate are we updating the bias? So v dot, since that's the derivative of the logarithm is 1 over the argument, so this becomes proportional to 1 over the histogram, which is what we wanted. Of course, you cannot take 1 over the histogram, because at the beginning the histogram is equal to 0, so you have to add some factor in front, let's say 1 over a plus the histogram, so that at the beginning you have finite hills, otherwise the system explodes. So you have some factor here, plus the histogram, and then this means that you are adding the hill in the point where you are, and that you just have some factor, we will discuss all of them now. Okay? But basically this equation is exactly equivalent to this one. Okay, so the nice thing is that here, at least if you assume that this Gaussian function is a delta function, so it's small, what you can say is that you can, let's say, substitute this expression. So here you can derive n as a function of v, and you can replace it here. And if you do all the calculations, it's just boring algebra. It turns out that you don't even have to look at the histogram. You don't even have to accumulate the histogram, because you already have the bias, which is, of course, related to that. And you can just say that v dot, so the speed at which you grow, you add sand, is not omega times delta, but it's like scaled down by a factor e to the minus v over delta t. This delta t is an energy which is appearing there. Okay, here I'm working with kb equal to 1, just to simplify the formula. Okay, so this means if you scale down the hill, and every time you add a new hill, you scale it down with a factor e to the minus the bias in that point over delta t, you will get something where the bias diverges logarithmically, or, same thing, the speed decreases like 1 over the histogram, which is what we wanted to have. And this delta t parameter tells you how quickly you are decreasing it. Okay, so let's see what happens then when you try to do this. So in the long time limit, what happens is that your bias will grow, but it will not grow uniformly. So if the bias plus the free energy is flat, it will not grow uniformly, because in some places you will put high hills, in other places small hills. Okay, so the speed at which it grows on average will be equal to some prefactor, which is completely irrelevant, is omega k, just the normalization of the Gaussian, whatever, and then times the factor that you use to scale down the height of the Gaussian, which is e to the minus v over delta t, times the probability of being at that point, because after some time you will have like this is your original free energy. This is maybe your. This is f plus v. This is v. And so the system will stay sometime here, and sometime here, sometime here, with a relative probability which is just the canonical distribution for the biased ensemble, so f plus v. So you see you have e to the minus f plus v over t. That's the probability of being at point s. Okay, in the long time limit when your bias is growing so slowly, assume your system to be at equilibrium. And then if you say, okay, I impose that this v dot is equal to, not to zero, it's constant with respect to s, so that I assume that my bias is growing parallel to itself, so like this. What you can get out of this is that if you just take the exponent there, which is the only part that depends on s, and take it equal to a constant, you get that this is equal to a constant. You can reverse the equation, and you will find that in the limit of long time, v will not become equal to minus f, it will become equal to minus delta t over t plus delta t times f. You see that this v is not the negative of the free energy, but it's a scaled down version of it, because this factor is less than 1. And you see that you are not going to compensate completely the underlying free energy barriers, but just to scale them down by a factor that you decide a priori. Let's say you choose delta t equal to 10 times t, like to 3000 Kelvin. You are going to scale down your barriers by a factor 11. It's 10 over 1 plus 10. Okay? So in this way, you can see that in metadynamics, you are scaling your barriers down by a factor infinite. You are completely dedating them. In this algorithm that we dubbed the well-tempered metadynamics, you are scaling them down by a finite fraction that you decide a priori. So this is very much the same of saying that you are going to sample your collective variable at a different temperature, T plus delta T. Okay? Because if you like, if you decrease, if you have that the final total force is corresponding to like barriers which are half of the original ones, it's like temperature which is twice. You can decrease the temperature, you can increase the effective temperature of the collective variable by an arbitrary factor that you decide at the beginning of your simulation. And so this is very similar to temperature accelerator MD that you have seen in the talk by Cameron a few days ago. It's exactly the same goal. The only difference is that in this case, this was not a goal. This was a bug. And then we realized that indeed it was very useful. Okay? And there are also other algorithms in the literature which have also been designed with the same spirit. To sample collective variables at a different temperature. The main difference is that in this case, the advantage of this algorithm with respect to temperature accelerator MD is that we don't have to require adiabatic separation here. Formally, the matrix is going to work even if you don't have adiabatic separation. Even if the collective variable is not much lower than the other variables. This is the good point. The bad point is that you have to build an histogram. So it doesn't work since the beginning. At the beginning, when there is no history accumulated, you have normal MD, and then slowly you build up your bias. So you have a longer transient at the beginning. And moreover, since you have to build the histogram, you have to fill the collective variable space in a sense, and it cannot be like 27 dimensions as it was showing. It should be like 2-3 dimensions, 4 dimensions maximum, let's say. On the other hand, you don't need to assume adiabatic separation. Okay, so that's it in action. So indeed, this green line is what you want to become flat, which is the error in your estimate, which is like the exact free energy minus the estimate. And the estimate is not minus the bias, but it's this expression here, like it's T plus delta T over delta T times V. So you can just reverse this equation and see that you can find F from V. So if V is 9/10 of F, F is 10/9 of P, of course. Okay? And you see that green line is becoming flatter and flatter. And the very nice thing is that if you go to delta T equal to infinite, what you get, it's possible to show that you get like flat histogram and you get back to normal metadynamics. And indeed, we were scaling down the collective, the hills by a factor e to the minus V over delta T. Of course, if delta T is infinite, we are not scaling them down, and we'll go back to normal metadynamics. On the other hand, if delta T is equal to zero, you can show that no bias is added, because basically, every time you try to add the Gaussian, this term goes down to zero. No bias is added, so it's Boltzmann sampling. So it's very nice. You have something in between metadynamics, which is flat histogram, and Boltzmann sampling, which is big barriers. And you can choose how far you are from each other. So and you can say, I want to decrease a lot the free energy barriers, or I want just to decrease them. I want just to pass barriers on the order of 5 kcal. Imagine that you are standing like isomerization. Barriers typically can be like 5 kcal, 10 kcal. You don't care about a barrier which is 100 kcal. That would be like breaking some chemical bond. Okay? So if you use delta T equal to energy unit, 5 kcal, 10 kcal, you know that you are not going to pass barriers which are 100 kcal high. You are not going to completely fill the free energy space, the collective variable space, but you are not interested in filling it completely, because you don't want to go to the region with the energy which is completely senseless. And here you see why this is a very good feature. It's not a bug of the method. Yes.
Does that mean you can get kind of reliable dynamics of the simulation still?
It's not reliable. It's never reliable when you have like the barrier instead of being so the original barrier was 10 kcal, you decrease it by a factor 10, it becomes 1k cal. It's good because you pass it, and of course, if you pass it, the dynamics is broken. You don't have to wait maybe 1 millisecond for it to be passed. So the dynamics is completely broken anyway. Yeah? So you see, the reason why we dubbed it delta t is that this, the temperature at which we sample the collective variable is e to the minus f over some effective temperature, which was the same, it was t bar maybe in temperature accelerator and d, it was called.
And we, so parameter.
It's a parameter, it's an input parameter. Okay. And let's say if delta t is equal to 3000 Kelvin, it means that t plus delta t is 11 times more than t.
Okay.
Yes?
What if you use to the new system, then, for example, you don't know how high is the barrier from some collective variable.
Yes.
So how do you choose that?
Okay, so I will show you that the result is not very sensitive to this choice, but you just need to fix the order of magnitude. See, of course, you know if your barrier will be 10 kcal or 100 kcal. This, you should know it from the beginning. Okay? But if you don't know it, I think that you don't even have a look at the problem. Typically, you know the order of magnitude of the reasonable order of magnitude. Maybe you don't know if it's 10 or 20, which is a huge difference. But you should know if it's 10 or 100. Okay, so very new system. Two minima, you know it already. Okay, I don't discuss this. This is obvious. What we want to do is metadynamics on these two collective variables. And I want to show you which is the effect of this delta t parameter. Okay, so we run different well-tempered metadynamics using different choices of this delta t parameter. And you see that if delta t is small, you are going to just sample the low energy states. Anyway, you are going to pass the barrier. Okay, because even a very small delta t is enough to pass this barrier, because this barrier is not so high. But you see that in this way, the nice thing is that you are focusing your exploration on regions of relatively low free energy. And as you increase delta t, you explore more and more. If you go to very high delta t, you will explore everything. Which could be good if you want to explore everything, but which could be bad if you are like in two or three dimensions and you want to focus on physically relevant regions. That's why it's used to fix this delta t. And this argument holds exactly the same for temperature accelerator and d. Also in that case, you fix t bar because of that. You don't want to explore everything blindly. So the goal is the same, but the two protocols are very different. They have important differences.
You said that in the limit of high temperature, high delta t, you need to be approaching regular metadynamics.
Exactly, and in regular metadynamics.
If that limit already looks to that.
You can see it. It depends on what you mean with close. You can see that points are almost uniformly scattered, but not perfectly. Okay, so you see that, for example, here you're not arriving. The only way to sample everything flatly is to go to delta t really equal to infinity. Okay, so our starting point was, let's solve the problem of metadynamics that fluctuate, gives error, and so we want to decrease the height of the yields on the fly so that the error decreases. Let's see if it's true that this error decreases. So you compute the free energy difference between A and B as a function of time for different values of that delta T. And this is our estimate that we get. You see that you see the fluctuations, because sometimes you overestimate, sometimes you underestimate. Your bias is growing like this, but these fluctuations are damped and they become smaller and smaller. And indeed, it can be shown that as they should, the amplitude of these fluctuations decreases as 1 over square root of time. And it should be like this, because this method is based on sampling. And so you cannot beat this law for how the error decreases with time. So to have like an error which is 1/4, you need twice more samples. There is no way to beat this relation. Okay, something that you can optimize anyway, so you have this scaling law, but you could say, I have a big prefactor or a small prefactor. Of course, what I care is not the scaling law. What I want is a small error. Okay, in practice, you want your result to be accurate. And so you can try to see how This is just technicality. You can see how the error decreases with time, I mean, computing the prefactor. And of course, to do this, you need a very accurate estimation of the, a very accurate calculation of the exact result. It's not experiment in this case, for example. In this case, it's just a very long calculation done maybe with an independent method. So you have a reference result, you can compute the error with respect to the reference result. And you can do an average over many trajectories. This, I think, is done over 100 trajectories. And what you obtain is that the error, so this is the error times square root of time, which is something that if the error decreases the square root of time, should become flat, right? And its value is the prefactor. If the error is like k over square root of time, you take the error times square root of time and you get k. And you see for different values, of course, at the beginning the error can become large and then it converges to something which is straight, which is flat. And then from the value here you can say how much is the prefactor, and you can see it, how it depends on delta t. You see that for delta t is equal to zero, the prefactor is going to be very high because you will see a very few events. The barrier is still too high to be passed. For delta t equal to infinite, also the error, also this will not happen because for delta t equal to infinite, in normal metadynamics, you will have infinitely long fluctuation. And so, of course, it should diverge, this factor, when you go for to large delta t. And of course, if it diverges here, and diverges here, in the middle, it should have a minimum. At least one minimum. Okay, in this specific case, it has a minimum which is around a choice, which is delta t equal to, let's say, 1000 Kelvin. So this means that you can just raise your effective temperature by 1000 Kelvin, which means that the effective temperature of the collective variable will be like 1300 Kelvin, or that's four times the original temperature, which means you are decreasing your effective barriers by a factor of four, and then they become affordable. Okay? Okay, you have another parameter, which is the initial rate of deposition, because your fields are anyway like scaled with this factor, but still you have like this original height. So you have one extra parameter in well-tempered metadynamic simulation. And so how can you test its the impact? So you have seen the results are rather stable with respect to delta t. So the method converges irrespective of its value in a very wide range. There is an optimal choice, but you can see that this prefactor is not so different. Let's say you have a decrease in efficiency by, let's say, 30% if you miss the optimal value of delta t by a factor 3. Okay, so you see that even having the order of magnitude of delta t is enough to have a reasonable convergence. Okay, you don't need to work in this exact case to find this optimal value of delta t. It's not necessary. Then what about the other parameter, so the height of the hill, the prefactor of the height? So that basically depends on the speed of the other collective, of the other reaction curve, of the other, sorry, of the variables which are orthogonal to the one that you are accelerating with metadynamics. So let's say that you have a two-dimensional case. This is the same free energy from RNA peptide, but then we use just a two-dimensional Langevin equation on this to build a toy model. And we do metadynamics only on one of them. Okay, and then this system is very nice because you can artificially slow down the orthogonal variable just using a smaller diffusion coefficient for that. Okay? And if you do it for different values of d, so if the orthogonal variable is fast or if the orthogonal variable is slow, you can see that basically what is going to change, this is the error, is a function of time. What is going to change when you change this, oh sorry, this is tau b, this is just another way of stating the value of this omega. So tau b small means high deposition rate, and tau b large means slow deposition rate. What you change is just the transient, but anyway, for very wide choices of this parameter, basically you always your result is always converging. Okay, so basically the fact that your results converge should not depend too much on the choice of the height, the absolute value of the height of the hills. So hills are like W times this scaling down factor. The factor in front is not so relevant. you don't have something like the fluctuation in the previous case. In normal metadynamics, the fluctuations depend on the choice of W. Larger W means bigger error. In this case, what you are impacting only is the transient. Okay, so just to resume this briefly, this part. So this technique with temporary metadynamics was designed so as to solve the problem of metadynamics that does not converge, because if you have like finite hills, you continue to add finite hills to your simulation, you will have like these fluctuations. So we try to decrease the height of the hills on the fly during the calculation. We find the proper scaling law for that, the optimal scaling law for that. We realize that the system doesn't work, that the method doesn't work anymore, and we realize that what we added is a very nice feature, which is the fact that you can decide which portion of the phase space you are sampling. You can choose a small delta t and just sample the relevant minima, or you can use a higher value of delta t and sample also higher minima, maybe, or metastable state, or transition state better, and so on. So this is, it's true that it's an extra parameter that you have to choose on one hand, but on the other hand, it decreases the impact on the result of the other parameter, which was this omega, this W in front, sorry, the height of the hills. So on one hand, you decrease the impact of the other parameter on the simulation, and on the other hand, you can tune, you can do something useful and decide how large is the region of the phase space that you want to explore. Which is something that is pretty easy to choose a reasonable value of delta T, because it's something related to the kind of physics that we are studying. Of course, if you want to study a chemical reaction, you should use a very high value of delta T. Okay? Any question?
This method is similar to, I don't know if you know the method of Nakamon bias to the
hyperdynamic
method.
Yeah, hyperdynamics, I know it,
yeah. And in Nakamon bias, you choose an energy value and fit the compressed potential energy.
Yeah. So that method in principle acts on the total potential energy, but then they use it also like on subset of the potential energy, let's say the dihedral energy, right? Mm-hmm. And in that case, it's something which goes close to using this method, using dihedrals as collective variables, let's say.
There are similar, so.
Yeah, there is some analogy, but it's the real difference is that this method is applied on collective variables.
Okay.
So this is really a very big difference, because this you apply it on gyrations radius of a molecule. If you want to look at changes of gyrations radius, you can choose one torsion and apply to it. So the way it's used, I think it's rather different, but there is maybe some analogy. Okay, so now I want to tell, yes?
So if you exchange the like Hamiltonian in this case, like as you do in the Africa exchange.
Yeah.
So and use metadynamics at the same time.
Yeah.
Would it be like, are there any caveats to that
approach? No, because in replica exchange, in Hamiltonian replica exchange, the only thing that you have to know is it's like U one of Q one plus V one of Q one. Let's say this is I J. And you have to compute it for I equal to J and for I different from J. It's exactly the same calculation that you do with normal metadynamics plus parallel tampering, which was not mentioned yet. So, yeah, but okay, Max will discuss this in detail in the next lecture. Yeah, you're right, there is a caveat, and in this, we didn't discuss it yet, so we will see it later. Yes?
In practice, is it difficult to have
yes, of course. Of course, in metadynamics, you have to build a reasonable bias, and so you have to fill the collective variable space, not entirely, in this case, but only in its low free energy region, which is a good, very. Strong advantage, because instead of filling, let's say, a cube, you have to fill just a portion of it which makes sense. But still, if you increase the number of dimensions that you use, the region that you have to fill is bigger and bigger. And so typical application goes up to, so typical, let's say, up to 3 collective variables. And then there are exceptional cases. The maximum that I have seen is like 6 collective variables. But it's very extreme use. You have to be a bit careful if you use it with 6 collective variables. I think I would say that the typical choice is 2 or 3 collective variables. Okay, now we have discussed, I think, quite in detail the point of optimizing this factor, like the height of the hill during the simulation. And we never talked about the width of the hill. And now I want to briefly tell you something that we have done recently. So it's not something that we already know. This method has not been really applied to many systems. So and also it's not yet available. So the other method, well-temperate thermodynamics, of course, is available in Plume, and we will play with it this afternoon. The thing that I'm going to show you now is like more some perspective thing. It's something that we published recently, and it's not yet in the official version of Plume. But I just want to have an idea of what's possible to do if you want to adapt the width of the hills during the simulation. So imagine that you have a case where you have one very narrow basin and one very large one. Okay. So if you estimate your fluctuations from here, you will say, I need a lot of resolution. I'm going to use very narrow Gaussians. It will be very good here. Then you jump on the other side, and you are trying to paint a paper with a pencil completely, and it takes a lot of time to explore all of this with small Gaussians. On the other hand, if you fix the Gaussian width from this, starting from here, you will have, like, you will try to reproduce some very fine drawing using like a very big pen, which doesn't work. You will not be able to fill this minimum using big Gaussians. So of course, something, the obvious thing is, why don't we choose them on the fly? Okay? So this is one point that we discussed. The other point is when you are in 2 dimensions, why should we use a Gaussian which is, let's say, aligned with the 2 collective variables, with the 2 axes? Let's say, why should we use a Gaussian like this, or like this, and not like this? Okay, so indeed, the variance of your Gaussian, the sigma, should not be like one parameter for each collective variable, but it could be like a matrix. You can imagine to say that your element is like this, this shape. Okay? So this means that you could try to use yields which are not just defined by 2 parameters, sigma on this collective variable and sigma of this collective variable, but by a 3rd parameter, which is the coupling between them, basically. Okay. So in that case, imagine that you want to do the standard estimation. You estimate from the fluctuation of the collective variable the width of these hills. It's very okay. So the expression of the yields will be like proportional to a Gaussian with this shape, with a multivariate Gaussian with a not necessarily diagonal covariance matrix here. So if it's diagonal, then you go back to the thing where it's aligned with the axis. But this could be a non-diagonal matrix. And how to estimate it? You can estimate it from the average, from the fluctuations, and from the autocorrelation, from the correlation between the 2 variables. You see, instead of computing the average of delta S squared, you can compute just the average of delta S I times delta S j. And in this way, you obtain this matrix. It means that if you do a short simulation and your system is going to fluctuate like this, this means that the proper shape to be chosen is like this one. Okay, so we have two points that we want to discuss. One is using hills which are not necessarily aligned with the 2 axes. This is one novelty with respect to before. The other novelty is, why don't we try to choose the width, or better, the shape in this case, on the fly? So the simplest way to do it on the fly is to do something where you recompute this variance simulation. And if you want to compute the variance, you have to say something like, you do a small simulation. This is just the collective variable space that you are monitoring. There are, of course, 1,000 atoms moving behind the scene. You monitor 2 collective variables, you look at this, and then you add the Gaussian with this shape. Then you go on to another piece of trajectory, And then when you want to add the new Gaussian, you put it like this. Another piece of trajectory, a Gaussian like this. So it could be like round, or it could have some fancy shape, and it adapts automatically to the free energy landscape that you have like behind that you have below here. Okay, so of course, if you do it in this way, you just take you can take the average point. In this way, you are not adding a Gaussian in the point where you are, but you are adding it in the average point that you explore in the past piece of trajectory. Okay, but this is not so nice because you have like a discontinuous approach, and so it's better to recast it in a way which is continuous. Instead of doing an average over, let's say, the last 1,000, you do an exponentially weighted average. So you just consider a factor, a tau, a time. Let's say you want to average over the past picosecond to choose the hill's shape. And instead of choosing exactly the last picosecond, you weight all the past trajectory with a weight which is e to the minus how far it was in the past divided times 1 picosecond. So this factor tells you how much you are taking into account very old points of the trajectory. Because of course, when you are here, you don't want to take into account anymore these points, otherwise you will add very big hills like this. Okay? So, and the same you do it for the variance. It's just a complicated formula, but it's very simple to implement. So notice that I told you already that you are not necessarily putting hills in the place where you are now, because you are putting it on the average point that you explored. And so when you add the hills in different places, they will have different shape and also different sides. You could have like, you go, the system doesn't fluctuate and you put a very small hill. This is very important, we will see it. And also you notice that instead of specifying the width of the hill, let's say that you are using two angles. You should specify the width on one angle, the width on the other angle, and then the sigma 1,2, the cross-correlation parameter. Instead of specifying these three parameters when you do the simulation, you just specify one, which is a time. This means that you measure the size of the hills not in units of collective variable, but in units of time. Which means, you say that, so I told you already that the width of the hill means when you consider two points to be equivalent. So, a distance equal to 1 angstrom or 1.1 angstrom is the same. So I can use a width of 0.1 angstrom. Here what I say is, if two points can be reached one from the other in 1 picosecond, they are the same point. I don't care about the difference. Is that clear? Yes?
I wanted to clarify what you meant by weight there.
Different weight, I mean, I mean the amount of sand to which they correspond.
Okay, but you don't mean...
They could have the same height if... Sorry?
That I understand, okay.
Okay, and... Sorry, this tau G should be tau D.
As time progresses, still at a certain point, you would have, overlapping Gaussians from different points in here.
Yeah, of course, because they accumulate one over the other. In this sketch, they are not overlapping, but as you go on, they grow.
Slow down the simulation.
No, even in normal metadynamics, they accumulate one over the other.
Yeah, right. So even in normal metadynamics,
yeah.
Slow down the simulation considerably as it progresses, since you need to keep tracking your energy potential
Yes. So this is not related to this algorithm, but in general to metadynamics. Yes, it slows down. There are tricks to do it. For example, instead of keeping track of everything, build the bias on a grid. It's a technicality if you want.
Okay, then you don't need to.
Yeah. It's a technicality. Okay, so this is one possibility to adapt the hills according to the evolution of the system. There is another possibility which I like it more. Which is, what I said here is, I consider two points to be the same point if they are close in time, if you can reach one from the other in less than 1 picosecond. Okay? But then to know this, you have to like estimate time scales. But something which is even more direct to you is, you can say two configurations are the same if they are closer than 0.1 angstrom, or 1 angstrom. So how can you say, how can you measure distance in collective variable space in units of angstrom? In units of how much the atoms have to move to have that displacement. So to do that, you simply have to choose your sigma, so your width. It's not really the width, it's the shape. You have a full matrix to be chosen. In this way, so you have a parameter in front, and then you have a sum over all the atoms, and then the gradients of the collective variables with respect to the atom. And if you do, so of course you need the parameter in front, because S is measured in whatever, apple or pear, and Q is in angstrom. And so if that sigma G is in angstrom, then the final units for sigma ij are correct. Okay, so this means, what's the meaning of this? This means that you have like your atoms here, coordinate. And imagine, you don't displace any atom, you don't do a small trajectory. You just take your present coordinates. And you say, what happens if I displace virtually by one angstrom the atoms? And you look at how much the collective variables would change. Of course they would change. They would move around this point, and let's say that they change in this way. Then what you do is, okay, the hill that I want to add, oh sorry, has this shape. If I add the hill with this shape, this means that I'm considering two points in the collective variable space to be the same point, to be in the same bin, let's say, if the macroscopic coordinates below are in bin, let's say, one angstrom. Did you get this point? Okay, so again, instead of choosing one matrix of parameters, or one diagonal matrix in the simplest form where you have like independent collective variables, then what you do is you choose one distance. You measure sigma in unit of angstrom. I want hills with a width of one angstrom, even if they are angles. Okay, now this has some implication. As I told you, the fact that you add different hills of different size in different points of space, similar to what we had in well-tempered metadynamics. If you add different hills of different size in different points, you have some sort of error, then you can discover that it's a feature. Even this error can be shown that it's a feature. I will not go into details, but again, what you get is that the usual relationship between bias and free energy changes. And basically, if you try to do the estimate blind using the normal formula that you have in well-tempered metadynamics, you don't estimate F, you estimate something which is F minus KBT times logarithm of the average value of the area of the Gaussian in that point. Okay, and this quantity has a name. In the literature, it's called gauge invariant free energy. But okay, just to tell you that if you use this algorithm, you don't have to estimate free energy using minus bias times that factor as you do with well-tempered metadynamics. There is some tricky thing to do. Okay, then just a very quick application I want to show you. On this free energy profile that I was showing at the beginning as a nasty case. And this is a nasty case because in some region you have like, if this collective variable is large and this collective variable is small, you would like to have like a hill with this shape. Whereas here you would like to have a hill with this shape. And maybe here you would like to have hills which are like round. Okay? So this is the free energy profile. It is the final result of the simulation. And this plot is like a representation of which are the typical shapes that you are adding in different points in the collective variable space. So you see that automatically, this is done in this geometrically based choice. So the sigma is like one angstrom, or it was like 0.1 angstrom, and automatically this shape comes out. Okay, this is just to give you an idea of what can be done, because this method is not yet widespread, so it's also time to do more tests and to see it on more realistic applications. Okay, and very briefly, the idea of this method is not that of adding a new parameter and a new 2D tuning parameter, but in decreasing the number of parameters, having something simpler to run. Instead of choosing, if you have like three collective variables, instead of choosing three numbers, you just choose one, which is in units that you know from the beginning what they mean. It could be time or it could be space. Okay? And the nice thing is that it adapts to the various regions of the collective space, and typically it's able to recognize the difference between narrow wells and wide wells. And I think I'm finished. And maybe there is time for one question. Any question or comment? Yes?
In this approach, if you're using the multidimensional collective variable, do they have to have the same dimensions?
No.
They all have to be length, and then you have
no.
An angle and length.
No, no, you don't. That's why in my example I was saying apple and pear, because S1 could be in apple and S2 could be in pear. They don't need to be the same. And indeed, this is a very easy way to have a reasonable parameter for the cross correlation. Exactly. And then instead of saying the sigma of RMSD is something, the sigma of torsion angle is something else, you just use one parameter. You say the sigma is 0.1 angstrom, and it automatically chooses the shape of the eels, even if they have different units. In this sense, it's simpler. Yes?
Is it possible to have a single set of parameters for all cases and like